स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू माय लाइव टीचिंग लर्निंग सेशन ऑफ प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ मैक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स बीईसीसी 133। टुडे वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट क्वांटिटी थ्योरी ऑफ मनी, क्रेडिट क्रिएशन और मनी मल्टीप्लायर एंड मॉनेटरी पॉलिसी। ऑल दिस टॉपिक्स वी विल कवर इन टुडेज टॉपिक, टुडेज क्लास। सो first of all we will discuss about quantity theory of money. It is also known as Fisher's transaction approach. This quantity theory of money was introduced by Irving Fisher. The most influential theory of money is called quantity theory of money. Firstly, it was proposed by David Hume in two articles of the Political Discourses of Money and of Interest. A modern interpretation was given by Milton Friedman as a stable money demand function. Quantitative easing was an application of the quantity theory of money, and this theory was opposed by or criticized by Adam Smith and John Maynard Keynes and other Cambridge University economists, but for different reasons. Quantity theory of money is very important theory in money unit, because this quantity theory of money explain the relationship between money supply and price level. And it also explains the relationship between money supply and value of money. And third, it explains the relationship between quantity, price level and money value. Three relationship explained by Irving Fisher under this quantity theory of money. Now this, the definition of quantity theory of money is, according to Irving Fisher, who propounded transaction approach of quantity theory of money, according to him, one of the normal effect of an increase in the quantity of money is an exactly or proportionately or directly increase in the general level of prices. In simple words, we can say that this theory tells us that how much increase in money supply will affect the general price level in the economy. According to Irving Fisher, whenever money supply increases, price level will also increase by the same ratio or proportionately. It means if money supply doubles, then price level will also be double. And if money supply will be half, then price level will be half. It means there is a positive, direct or proportionate relationship between quantity theory of money and general price level. Quantity means money supply. Money supply or quantity of money is equivalent. So we can explain that this money supply directly affects the general price level. And the value of money is called the purchasing power of money. How much money can purchase the units of goods and services? It explained by value of money. It means what is the purchasing power of money in real world. As we know that whenever price rises, the value of money falls. And when price falls, value of money increases. There is an inverse and indirect relationship between value of money and money price level. Price rises, money value falls. Price falls, money value rises. And third relationship is money supply and value of money are also inversely related and indirectly related with each other. Money supply rises, then value of money will fall. falls. When money supply falls, value of money will rise. It means this quantity theory of money explains the relationship between number one is money supply and price level. Both have direct, positive, and proportionate relationship between money supply and general price level. Second thing is price level and value of money has inverse relationship. It means if price level rises, value of money falls and vice versa. And third relationship is money supply and value of money. When money supply rises, value of money falls. When money supply falls, value of money rises. So Irving Fisher's quantity theory of money explain the three relationship between money supply, price level, and value of money. In this three relationship, first of all, you have to know what is money supply. Money supply is the quantity of money which is issued by or circulated by RBI. As you know that RBI is the apex institution of monetary authority, and RBI has monopoly power to issue paper currency, coins, notes, etc. Only 1 rupee note is issued by Ministry of Finance, Government of India. But rest of the currency are issued by RBI. So whenever RBI issue paper currency, it means money supply rises. And due to rise in money supply, general price level will also rise. Its main reason is when money supply rises, it means circulation of money will rise. Then people purchasing power will also rise. When the demand of the country people rises, but supply can't increase due to scarcity of resources, in this case, price level will rise. So there is a direct and proportionate relationship between money supply and general price level, according to Irving Fisher. Second thing is there is an inverse relationship between quantity of money or money supply and value of money. Value of money tells us the purchasing power of money. How much unit we can purchase with the existing money which we have. If price rises, purchasing power of the country people will fall. And if price falls, then our purchasing power will rise. So there is an inverse relationship between quantity of money and value of money, and money supply and price level and value of money. Now, what are the assumptions of this theory? According to Irving Fisher, demand for money remains constant. We assume that in this theory that demand for money remains constant. Second thing is trade and business activities should also remain constant. Third is supply of credit money remains constant. Velocity of money tells us the speed of money. How much money circulate in the economy and how much transactions we done with the help of money, and this velocity or speed of money should not change or remains constant. And according to Irving Fisher, because all the classical economics assume that their theory will be applicable only in the long period, time period, not in short period. So Fisher assumed that this theory will applicable only in long run, not in short run. And according to him, full employment always exists in each and every economy. But this assumption is unrealistic because full employment does not exist in each and every country, either it may be developed or underdeveloped or developing. At present, full employment does not exist in any country. All countries are suffering from the problem of unemployment. And according to Keynes, at the level of full employment, 5% to 6% unemployment may be exist. That is called natural rate of unemployment in which voluntarily people may be unemployed. So these are the assumptions of this theory. First is demand for money remains constant, velocity should remain constant, time period will be long time period, full employment exists in the economy, and transactions and money demand for transaction purpose should remain constant, supply of credit money should remain constant. These are the assumptions which is assumed by Irving Fisher when he propounded this quantity theory of money. Next is quantity theory of money. The equation of this theory is MB is equals to PT. Here M is money supply, V is velocity, P is general price level, and T is transaction. So MV, it means MV denotes money supply and PT denotes money demand. And according to Irving Fisher, under this quantity theory of money, money supply is always equals to money demand. So MV is equals to PT. Here M is total amount of money in the economy. Next is V is velocity in the circulation of money, which is also known as speed of money. And P is general price level in the economy. And T is total index of physical volume of transactions. As we know that money is a very good medium of exchange. At present, all the goods and services can sell or purchase with the help of money. So T denotes transaction, which is the most important motive of holding money in cash form according to classical economics and according to Keynes also, transaction motive. So T is transaction. MV is equals to PT. This is the equation of quantity theory of money propounded by Irving Fisher. Next is the diagram of quantity theory of money. In this diagram, the first figure shows that there is a direct and proportionate relationship between quantity of money and general price level. In this, price level is on y-axis and quantity of money we have taken on x-axis. Whenever money supply rises or quantity of money rises, price level will also rise. If money supply falls, price will fall. If money supply rises, price will rise by the same ratio. That's why this diagram is 45 degree line. 45 degree line always represent the direct and proportionate relationship between two variables. Either it may be price level and quantity of money, or it may be transaction motive. Another figure is showing that there is an inverse relationship between quantity of money or money supply and value of money. Value of money has written on y-axis and quantity of money is written on x-axis. Whenever quantity of money or money supply increases, the value of money will fall. And when money supply falls, then value of money will rise. So there is an inverse relationship between value of money and quantity of money. That's why this diagram is downward sloping curve or negatively sloped curve from left to right. These two diagrams representing the direct and proportionate relationship between quantity of money and price level, and other diagram is showing that there is an inverse relationship between value of money and quantity of money, same as there is an inverse relationship between value of money and general price level. Next is, if this equation is propounded by Irving Fisher, but this is called modified equation. Because first of all, Irving Fisher gives only MV is equals to PT equation. But some economics criticize and said that Fisher ignore some variables which must be included in its equation. And these variables are M dash and V dash. This M dash shows change in money supply. And V dash shows change in velocity of money. When some economists suggested to Irving Fisher that you should include these two components also in your equation, then Fisher realized that these components are must or necessary to include in this equation. Then equation will be modified, and equation is now M is money supply, V is velocity, plus M dash change in money supply, V dash change in velocity of money, divided by T. T is transaction, and here P is equals to this. Or we can write in this form, MV plus M dash V dash, this whole equation is showing money supply, and PT is showing money demand. If we want to calculate the value of P, then MV plus M dash V dash will be divided by T. If we have given the value of M, quantity of money or money supply is 1000 and velocity is given 3, then M into V, 1000 into 3, plus if M dash value is given 500 and V dash value is given 2, then it will be 1000 divided by T, transaction value is 4000, then price level will be equals to 1 rupee per good. Here the value of money can be calculated by the reciprocal of price or 1 by P. 1 by P is the formula of value of money. If the supply of money is doubled, this is a formula and this numerical is showing that how we can explain the relationship between money supply and general price level, which is always proportionately or directly according to Irving Fisher, we can explain with the help of this equation. If the supply of money is doubled, doubled means if in the beginning this money supply is 1000 and double means 2000 it will be. So 2000 into 3 plus 500 double is 1000, 1000 into 2 upon 4000, then it will be 2000 into 3, yani ki 6000, and 1000 into 2, it means 2000, 6000 plus 2000, 8000 divided by 4000, it will be 2 rupees 2 per good. It means due to increase in money supply, price level will also double. If money supply doubles, then price level will also be double. If money supply will half, then price level will be half. So there is a direct and proportionate relationship between money supply or quantity of money and general price level. This theory explains this direct and proportionate relationship between price and money supply. So this is the main concept of quantity theory of money, and it can be explained with the help of this modified equation. And the initial equation was MV is equals to PT according to Irving Fisher. Next is cash balance approach. Cash balance approach was propounded by Cambridge University economist. Cambridge University economists are four. One is Marshall, second is Pigou, third is Robertson, and fourth is J.M. Keynes. They propounded cash balance approach regarding this quantity theory of money. That's why this approach is known as Cambridge University economics approach or cash balances approach. But the Fisher approach is transaction approach. Cash balances approach is a theory of money demand. Here Pigou argues that agent choose to allocate resources to a portfolio of assets based upon convenience and security. The issue is the proportion of allocated to allocation of money, and here K is the fraction of money which people want to keep cash or which people want to hold money in cash form. Here R is the rate of interest and K is the constant variable. R is refers to the attractiveness of rivals, uses of resources. As R increases, K falls. There is a discussion regarding the provision of security against unexpected demands due to sudden need or rise in prices. Keynes or Cambridge University economics mainly focused on money demand, but Fisher mainly focused on money supply. The basic difference between Fisher's and Cambridge University economics approach is that their main focus on money demand and money supply. Fisher's main focused on money supply and the Cambridge University economics main focused on money demand. That's why cash balances approach is also known as theory of money demand rather than theory of money supply. Next is money demand and quantity theory of money. Here Cambridge approach, according to this approach, M is equals to KPY. Here K is the fraction of spending that people have command over in the form of money balances, and K can be calculated by dividing 1 upon V. Both the equations of exchange and the cash balance approach are identical. Here V is the velocity of money. Manipulation of the equation of exchange results in the Cambridge cash balance approach or the demand for money equation. All Cambridge University economics explain differently by using different equations to this theory of quantity theory of money. Here Cambridge equations of cash balance approach, which is propounded by different Cambridge University economics, and these economics are Marshall, Pigou, Robertson and Keynes. The equation of Marshall is M is equals to KPY. Here M is money supply or quantity of money. K is the fraction of money income which people want to keep in cash form. P is price level and Y is income level. Equation of Pigou is P is equals to KR divided by M. Here K is the fraction of money income which people want to keep in cash form, and R is the ratio or required reserve divided by M. M is the money supply. And equation of Robertson given by this P is equals to M upon KT. Here M is the quantity of money or supply of money, and divided by K. K is the fraction which of money income which people want to keep in cash form, and T is transaction motive. People generally demand for money for transaction purpose, for day-to-day transactions or sale or purchase any commodity with the help of money. And equation given by Keynes is small n is equals to PK. Here small n denotes the supply of money, P is the price level, and K is the fraction of money income which people want to keep in cash form. So all these Cambridge University economics give different equations to express or explain the quantity theory of money in different ways. Next is the what is the basic difference between Fisher's equation and Cambridge equation. First of all, Fisher's equation gives importance to flow of money or circulation of money, but Cambridge equation stresses on stock of money, that money supply is a stock concept and money is issued by RBI at a particular point of time, not regular basis. Second is, according to Fisher's equation, P represent the general price level or average price level of all the goods and services which are produced in the economy. And Cambridge University's equation, in this equation P represent the price of only consumer goods, not all the goods. Third is, Fisher's viewpoint stress on supply of money. Fishers always focused on supply of money, but Cambridge viewpoint stresses on or emphasized on demand of money. Next is Fisher's equation is associated with period of time because it is related a flow concept, and flow concept is always related with period of time. And according to Cambridge equation, which is a stock concept, it is related with point of time. Next is, according to Fisher, the demand for money is generally for transaction purpose. But according to Cambridge University, people can hold money for three purposes. One is transaction purpose, second is precautionary purpose, and third is speculative purpose, which we have discussed in demand for money. And demand for money, according to Keynes, who is the Cambridge University economist, said that money is demanded for basically three purposes: transaction, precautionary, and speculative. So this is the basic difference between Fisher's equation and Cambridge equations. Next is criticism. According to Irving Fisher, there is a direct and proportionate relationship between money supply and price level. And whenever money supply rises, price level also rises. If money supply double, price level will double. If money supply falls or half, then price level will also be half. But Keynes criticized this. All the Cambridge University economics criticized the equation of Fisher and the theory of Fisher. According to Keynes, the quantity theory of money is a truism. It means this theory is real. This theory is true. But Fisher's equation of exchange is a simple truism because it states the total quantity of money, which is denoted by MV plus M dash V dash in Fisher's equation, paid for goods and services, must equals to PT. PT is price and transaction, but it can't be accepted today that a certain percentage change in quantity of money leads to the same percentage change in the price level. The assumption of Keynes is that whenever money supply rises, then price level will rise. There is no doubt, but not in the initial stage. Because when money supply rises, the rate of interest will fall. And due to fall in rate of interest, investment will rise. And due to rise in investment, production will rise. Due to rise in production, employment will rise. And this employment will rise continuously, or income will rise. This process will go on till the full employment will achieve. After achieving the full employment level, then this direct and proportionate relationship between money supply and price level will definitely held in the economy, but not before that. It means Keynes said that Fisher ignores the process in between of quantity of money and general price level. And he said that there is a direct and proportionate relationship between money supply and price level, and money supply and price level directly related, proportionately related, but not explained the whole process, how price level affected by increase in money supply. Under this, which is ignored by Irving Fisher. That's why Irving Fisher theory of quantity of money was criticized by Cambridge University economist, and according to Keynes, this theory is real, but not explain the whole process, how much step involved in this increasing price level due to increase in money supply, not explained by Irving Fisher. but was explained by J.M. Keynes. That's why cash balance approach is much superior than Fisher's quantity theory of money. So this is the criticism of quantity theory of money. And Fisher assumed that long period, time period, and full employment always exist. This is not real, not true. Keynes theory is applicable only in short run because Keynes assumed that our all problems occur only in short run. In long run, we all will die. No problem will occur in long run. When we will not alive, then problem will also not occur. So Keynes criticized the Fisher's quantity theory of money. So this is the basic concept of quantity theory of money, in which Irving Fisher and Cambridge University economics play very important role. And this theory, assumptions, equation, criticism is most important. Next topic is credit creation process or money multiplier. This is also in your money unit. How bank create credit? What is the process of credit creation? Under this process, credit creation, first of all, you must have to know about who create credit. So commercial bank create credit, and central bank always control this credit. Credit creation is the main function of commercial banks. Commercial banks always take deposits from the public and provide loans and advance facilities to the public or investors or businessmen or firms. So here bank is the commercial bank, like State Bank, Punjab National Bank, Canara Bank, Bank of Baroda, Bank of Maharashtra, Allahabad Bank, etc. All these banks are either it may be private banks or it may be public banks or it may be foreign banks, or banks are known as commercial banks who deals with public. So first of all, bank, under in this bank, commercial banks, people will save their money and deposits will go to bank by savers, and borrowers can take money through banks. So bank will lend money to borrowers. Savers will get interest after saving their money or deposited their money in banks, and borrowers has to pay interest to the banks after borrowing money from the bank. So this is the main process of how credit creation can held in the economy. Main simple function of commercial bank is to take deposits from the public and to provide loans and advance facilities to the borrowers. Next is money multiplier formula. What is the formula of money multiplier, and what commercial bank can create credit? What formula they use? So this is the formula: 1 upon required reserve ratio or 1 upon CRR. CRR is cash reserve ratio. We can use LRR, that is legal required ratio or legal reserve ratio. Money multiplier or money can be made multiply, or bank can increase multiply money with the help of this formula: 1 upon CRR, or we can use 1 upon required reserve ratio. This is the formula of money multiplier. Credit creation is also known as money multiplier, in which bank can increase money multiply with the existing deposits or money. Credit creation. What is the definition of this credit creation? When the bank buys government securities, it does not pay the purchase price at once in cash. As you know that people always save their money in banks for getting interest. And when the bank buys securities, government securities like shares, bonds, debentures, etc., it does not pay the purchase price at once in cash. It simply creates the account or credit the account of the garment with the purchase price. The garment is free to withdraw the amount whenever it wants by check. The power of commercial banks to expand deposits through loans, advances, and investment. This is known as credit creation. For example, if I have deposited 10,000 rupees in a commercial bank, that will be called primary deposits or initial deposits. According to me, that will be called asset, but according to bank, that will be liability, because bank has to pay that amount whenever I withdraw that money from the bank. So that 10,000 rupees which I have deposited in a bank initially, that will be called primary deposit. But all commercial banks work under the policy of the RBI, and RBI apex institution, RBI full control over all the commercial banks. Each and every commercial bank has to keep some certain amount, which is known as CRR, credit cash reserve ratio. Each and every commercial bank has to keep some amount, which is fixed by the RBI, certain percentage of deposited amount to the RBI. So remaining amount, if we assume that CRR is 10%, so 10,000, 10% is 1,000. Commercial bank will keep 1,000 rupees in RBI, and the remaining amount, which is 9,000, commercial banks are free to give for loans and advances to the borrowers. So 9,000 can make or increase multiply money. So credit creation process explain how commercial banks can create money or increase multiple money with the help of existing deposited money. Commercial bank can make 1,000 rupees to 10,000 rupees, 10,000 to 1 lakh rupees. It depends upon CRR or cash reserve ratio. How banks create money? For example, if we assume that required reserve ratio or reserve ratio is 10%, and if I have deposited 1,000 rupees in a bank, then 10% of 1,000 rupee is 100. Bank must hold 100 rupee as a reserve to the RBI. Bank can lend, it means commercial banks can give loan to 900 rupees to the public or borrowers, and 900 rupees bank will not give you loan by cash. You have to open account in bank, then bank will deposited that lending money in your account, and you can withdraw as according to their use, you can withdraw from the banks. So if a bank will give you 900 rupees, then you must have to open the account in a bank, and bank then again bank will deduct CRR. 900, 10% of 900 is 90, remaining amount will be 810, and 810 again bank will deduct 10%, 81 rupees, 729 will be left, and 729 10% is 72.9, 656.61 will be left, and this process will go on until the whole amount will be exhausted. So money multiplier we can calculate by using this formula, 1 upon reserve requirement. Or if the reserve ratio is 0.0, then what will be the money multiplier? As well as the required reserve ratio or CRR increases, money multiplier will be lower. It is inversely related. Credit creation is inversely related with CRR ratio. If CRR is higher, credit creation will be lower. If CRR is lower, credit creation will be higher. Because if CRR is higher, it means commercial bank has to keep more amount of their deposited money in RBI, then commercial bank capacity to give loans will fall and they will make less credit creation. So it is inversely related with CRR. This is the process of credit creation if we assume that only single bank exists in the economy. If we assume only single bank is working, which is not at present, this is not a realistic situation, but here we are taking example of only single bank. If only single bank is working in the economy, then how credit can create, or how a single bank can create credit? So first of all, the person, for example, we take that person A is deposited 1000 rupees in a bank, that will be called primary deposit. And if the CRR ratio, cash reserve ratio, is 20%, then 100, the amount of 20% of 1000 is 200 rupees, which every commercial bank has to keep in RBI. So the remaining amount left is 800 rupees, and commercial bank can give loans by 800 rupees to the borrowers. Then again, 800 rupees person B, if person B has get 800 rupees, then the CRR ratio 20%, 20% of 800 is 160, remaining amount is 640. Again, 640, person C is 640 amount will receive. 640, the deduction by 20% is 128, and the amount is 512, which commercial bank can give loan to another person, person D. 512 will get, but deducting 20% is 102, and bank can give again loan to 410, and this process will go on continuously until the whole amount will be exhausted. In this way, primary deposit, the summation of sum of primary deposit is 5000, and the cash reserve is 200 160 128 102 -, it will be 1000, and credit creation will be 4000. So if a primary deposit is 1000 and the CRR is 20%, then credit will be created by 4000. It means if this ratio will be 10%, then credit creation will be 10,000. So credit creation depends upon the ratio of CRR. If CRR increases, credit creation will decrease. If CRR decreases, credit creation will increase. This credit creation process can be explained with the help of this more banking system. If we assume that there is a multiple banking system exist in the economy, first, we assume that only single banking system is working in our economy. But here we are assuming that here multiple or more banks are working in our economy. For example, at present, there are so many banks, like public banks, private banks, foreign banks are working in our economy. So this is the realistic situation which exists in at present time period. So multiple credit creation by banking system, what is the process of credit creation under this multiple banking system? So this process will remain same. Process will not change. Only the number of rounds in that single banking system, we have taken person A, person B, person C, person D. But here we will take bank A, bank B, bank C, bank D, and etc. Here primary deposit, again we are taking only 1000 rupees. If I have deposited, then that will be called primary deposit or initial primary deposits. If cash reserve ratio is 20%, then 20% of this 1000 amount is 200. Again, initial excess reserve will be 800, or credit creation by bank will be by 800 rupees. Then again, this 800 will go to bank B. Again, 20% deduction, it means 160. The net amount credit creation for commercial bank is 640. This 640 will go to bank C, 640. Then deduction is 20%, 128. Again, 512. Then same as 512 will go to bank D. 512, the deduction of CRR is 102. And the credit creation or derivative deposit is 410. Same as this process will go on continuously until the whole amount will be exhausted. In this process, if CRR is 20%, then bank can make 1000 to 4000 rupees. if CRR is 10%, then bank can make 9,000 rupees or 10,000 rupees with the help of this deposited, primary deposited amount. Next is meaning of monetary policy. This is also the concept of money unit, monetary policy. That is very important topic. In credit creation process, you have studied about the functions of commercial bank, how commercial bank create credit, which is the most important function, how bank can create multiple money or generate multiple money, what is the process in a single banking system or in a multiple banking system. But here, this topic is monetary policy. Monetary policy is made by Reserve Bank of India, and this policy is that policy in which RBI can control credit creation and can control supply of money. Because RBI is the apex institution of monetary authority, or central bank has power to control money supply or regulate money supply and control credit creation process, which are done by commercial banks. It means monetary policy is essentially a program of action undertaken by the monetary authorities, generally the central bank, to control and regulate the supply of money with the public and flow of credit with a view to achieving predetermined macroeconomics goals. The main objective or main purpose of monetary policy are the same as of macroeconomic policy. The main objectives are, first is price stability. RBI can control inflation or deflation situation in the economy. RBI can control price level or increasing price level or decreasing price level, or RBI can stabilize the economic growth, and price stability is the main important function of monetary policy and main important work of the monetary policy or objective of the monetary policy is price stability, currency stability, financial stability, foreign exchange rate stability, growth in employment and income. These are the main objectives of monetary policy. In simple words, we can say that monetary policy is that policy which is made by Reserve Bank of India to control or regulate the supply of money and to control the credit creation process. Credit controlling is the main function of central bank, and credit creation is the main function of commercial banks. Monetary policy can make two types of policy, expansionary and contractionary. It means there are two types of monetary policy. One is known as expansionary and second is known as contractionary. Expansionary helps speed up the economy or boost economic growth. And contractionary policy helps to slow down the economy or calm economic growth. So these are the two types of monetary policy, expansionary and contractionary. It means RBI can use monetary policy tools to increase the supply of money and to decrease the supply of money. When RBI increases the supply of money, that will be called expansionary monetary policy. And if RBI decreases the supply of money, then it will be called contractionary monetary policy. Next is how central bank can contract or can increase or expand the credit creation or money supply. First, central bank hike interest rate. If central bank or Reserve Bank of India increases the interest rate, here this interest rate is borrowing interest rate, not saving interest rate. If RBI increases the interest rate of borrowing, then borrowing will be more expensive. Investors will take less loan from the bank. Investment will fall. Production will fall. Employment will fall. And inflation will control. Economy will contract. And if central bank cuts interest rate, it means if RBI provides loans and advance facilities at the cheaper rate, then economy will expand. How it will expand? Because at lower rate of interest, investors will encourage and take more loans from the banks. And if investors will take more borrowings, then investment will rise, production will rise, employment will rise, income will rise, then economy will expand and inflation increases. So RBI can reduce the interest rate or can increase the interest rate, depends upon RBI wants to control inflation situation or deflation situation. At the time of inflation, price rises continuously, and at the time of deflation, price falls continuously. If inflation increases, RBI follow that policy in which economic contract or contractionary monetary policy will be adopted by RBI. And if a deflation situation occur, then RBI will use expansionary fiscal, monetary policy to increase employment, income, investment, all these things. Next is instrument of monetary policy. What are the instruments of monetary policy? Here the monetary policy instruments are two. One is quantitative and second is selective credit control. There are two instruments which is adopted by the monetary policy or RBI to control credit or to control or regulate money supply. These are known as quantitative and qualitative. Under quantitative, we take only three measures. One is open market operation, second is bank rate and cash reserve ratio. And in selective credit control or qualitative credit control, measures are credit rationing, margin lending and moral suasion. What is open market operation? Open market operation is that operation in which RBI can sell or purchase securities like shares, bonds, debentures in an open market to the public. If RBI sells these securities to the public, then RBI will want to contract the money supply. If RBI sells these securities to the public, then public will buy and the cash money of the public will go to the RBI. So in this case, RBI can contract the credit creation or to contract the economy and to control the inflation. If RBI purchases securities from the public, in this case, the cash money from RBI goes to public. Public purchasing power will rise, demand will rise, and inflation will also rise. Then economy will be expand. So open market operation in this function, if RBI sells securities, then deflation problem will be solved. And if RBI sells securities to the public, it means inflation problem will be solved. And if RBI purchases securities from the public, then deflation problem will be solved. Next is bank rate. Bank rate is that rate at which RBI provides loans and advance facilities to the commercial bank. If bank rate increases, inflation problem will be solved. And if bank rate falls, deflation problem will be solved. And CRR, as you know that there is an inverse relationship between cash reserve ratio and credit creation. If CRR increases, credit creation will be lower, economy will be contract, and if CRR ratio is higher, then if CRR is lower, then economy will expand. If CRR is higher, then economy will contract. Under the selective credit control, credit rationing, same as rationing system, RBI can fix the limit or quota of credit. If RBI wants to control credit creation, then it will strictly follow that limit. But if RBI wants to increase the credit creation process, then RBI will not fix any type of this borrowings limit. Margin lending is the pledge amount or mortgaging amount. As you know that bank give loan by taking some mortgage or pledge amount by the borrower. If margin lending increases, then borrowing will be more expensive. Borrowers will take less loan from the bank, and in this case, economy will contract, inflation will be solved, and vice versa. Moral suasion is under this function, RBI can morally pressurize all the commercial banks to follow their policy to contract the money supply or to regulate the money supply and to control the credit creation. Next is expansionary monetary policy tools. Under this expansionary monetary policy, first of all, RBI will decrease the interest rate, and if RBI decrease the interest rate on borrowings, then investors will encourage and take more loans from the RBI or commercial banks. And if investors will take more borrowings from the bank, then investment will rise, then production will rise, then employment level will rise. And in this case, due to increase in investment, production, employment, income will rise, and economy will be in expansionary mode. So expansionary monetary policy tools, under this policy, RBI will decrease the interest rate of borrowings. And under contractionary monetary policy tools, RBI will increase the interest rate to contract the money supply in the economy. It means RBI has a full power to control money supply, to control inflation, and to stabilize the price level. Next topic is hot money. What is hot money? This hot money is that money which is demanded by all. That money which is moving rapidly from one investment to another. That is called hot money. The money moving rapidly internationally, that is called hot money. And the money which is earned from illegal activities, that is also called hot money. So hot money is that money which can be stolen, which need everyone, which people want to hold money, which is demanded by all or internationally, nationally, and which people want to increase money, that is called hot money. So in today's class or session, I have discussed with you three main topics of monetary unit. One was quantity theory of money, second was credit creation, and third is monetary policy. Money unit has so many topics like functions of money, what is money, what are the main functions of money, what is the important role of money in the economy, and why people want to hold money in cash form, what are the reasons behind this. That topic is related with demand for money. And the next topic in money unit was money supply. Under this topic, I have discussed with you what is money supply. Money is supplied by Reserve Bank of India, and money is a stock concept which is issued by Reserve Bank of India at a particular point of time. And quantity theory of money was introduced by Irving Fisher and criticized by J.M. Keynes. And credit creation process, under this process, credit creation is the main function of commercial bank, but credit controlling is the main function of Reserve Bank. So now this BECC 133 unit, all units are completed. Thank you.